I really need to get around to updating the opening theme one of these days.
Hey, poor! Hey, poor! Hey, poor! You don't have to be poor anymore! Jesus is here!
The loudspeaker spoke up and said,
greetings, fellow worker slaves, podcasting at 128 kilobits from the Fortress of Squalitude, not far from the Redneck Mecca. This is the Atheist in the Trailer Park podcast. I'm your host, Tucker. Professor Fuzznuts is right there by the keyboard demanding attention. Buddha is curled up on the shelf on the desk, asleep. Ash and Lord Squeakington are in my room, curled up. Yes, it's a podcast hosted by a guy and his cats. Get over it. This is a news show episode where I cover stories in the news that are related to things like atheism, secularism, science, or I find just plain interesting. Next episode will be a couple of chapters from the Pista Sophia. Well, it certainly wasn't an exciting week for me being off and all. I did manage to fuck up my sleep schedule, which was fun. Somehow I kept staying up later and later, and now I've got to get back on my normal sleep schedule, which means that even though I woke up at 1 this afternoon, I have to be in bed by about 10 tonight. Yay! I did manage to accomplish a couple of things this week. One is that I finally took some of the scrap wood I had in my storage building and used it to build a planter, as well as prep some more wood to build another one. Of course, I can't afford dirt to put into the planters, but hey, it's a start. I really need to get into the habit of growing more of my own food. I have a feeling that it's going to come in handy soon. The only other big news I have is that this week we had the monthly Democratic Party potluck. I had a friend translate the announcement into Spanish, and I posted it where many of my neighbors in the trailer park could see it. None of them showed up, but I'm not bothered by that. School started up this past week, so I'm sure that this might have had something to do with that. I know our turnout this month was a little lower than usual, but we did have some new people show up, which is a positive. My one gripe is that almost no one from the leadership committee showed up. Personally, I think that every member of the leadership committee should be at such an event, since we hold so few events. If we held a lot of events, I'd be more sympathetic to them missing one here and there. But since we only hold one really public event a month, it seems to me that they shouldn't miss any of them. I realize that's not always practical, but still less than half the members showed up with no explanation as to why they had to miss. One of them has kids, so that might have been it. The others, no clue. They don't have school-age kids. We did get a little bit of important news, however. One of the folks who sits on the County Election Commission was there, and he gave us an update on the next generation voting machines we should be getting in time for the 2022 election. These will record your vote on a paper tape, and if there's a recount of the election, that paper tape will be what's used, not the report from the machine. The machines have a printer and a roll of paper in them. The paper is under glass, so you can see it but can't touch it. When you're ready to submit your vote, it shows you the paper, then rolls it forward after you hit approve so that the next person can't see how you voted. This is different than the paper ballots which they have in Nashville. There, the machine spits them out and you hand them to a poll worker who can actually read who you voted for. They're supposed to hold the ballots so the votes aren't visible, but I think we all know how that's going to work out. Okay, let's get to the news.
I don't do miracles. They're too flashy, and they upset the natural balance.
No miracles, huh? I knew it.
Oh, maybe now and then just to keep my hand in. The last miracle I did was the 1969 Mets. Before that, I think you have to go back to the Red Sea. That was a beauty.
If you have Netflix and haven't watched the 5-part documentary called The Family, you need to stop what you're doing and watch that. Take a listen to the trailer.
In my 20s, I stumbled my way in. And what I found is a secretive Christian organization called The Family that had been hiding in plain sight for over 80 years.
This was a group with tentacles around the world.
A humble example of leadership that the world has never seen.
A breathtaking enmeshment of church and state.
There were congressmen, senators, world leaders.
And they say it's about faith. But there's a shared understanding that what we're really about here is power.
I'd like to single out Doug Coe.
Doug Coe and all of his associates, I'm grateful.
Doug Coe is the longtime leader of The Family.
He's the most powerful man in Washington you've never heard of.
He said the more invisible you can make your organization, the more influence it will have.
Jesus plus nothing. It's a powerful thing.
Using the National Prayer Breakfast, they dispatch representatives to build relationships with foreign leaders.
That is exactly the kind of meeting that I would want to exploit.
For The Family, Jesus says you must go to those who are in positions of power.
God always uses imperfect vessels to do his perfect work. President Trump's an imperfect vessel.
Jesus is the answer, but Jesus and Capitol Hill don't mix.
Because we want our family to stay together.
It's based on the book by Jeff Charlotte, and the executive producer was behind the HBO documentary on Scientology called Going Clear. And even if you've read the book, you're going to want to watch the series because it has video of Doug Coe, who's the previous head of The Family, espousing his philosophy behind the organization. It is all about power and secrecy. How they got some of the video, I have no idea, but it's pretty disturbing. And if you've studied the methods of indoctrination used by cults, you're going to be immediately twigging on a number of things. The same is true if you've read Eric Hoffer's book, The True Believer. While watching the series, I kept going back to a number of things he said in the book. What matters to the fanatic is not the contents of the cause, but the total dedication and the communion with the congregation was one thing that he wrote that I was reminded of. There are others, but I'm not going to belabor the point. I'm sure a lot of you are tired of hearing me talking about The True Believer. I just wish I knew more of you out there had read the book. The members of The Family, and those of you who grew up in areas where the mafia is prominent, might notice that they call themselves The Family, just as the mafia is sometimes referred to. That's no accident. They have film footage of Doug Coe in the series praising the mafia and its methods. And this group is very much all about dedication to the group, regardless of what a person's actions might be. So when they meet someone like Muammar Gaddafi, they don't raise the issue of human rights. They simply say that they are together in Christ and that God put Gaddafi in power as part of his divine plan. Oh, and according to these people, God doesn't give a shit about poor folks. The only people who matter to him are the rich and powerful. Another thing that Hoffer said, which I was reminded of while watching the series, is the fanatic is not really a stickler to principle. He embraces a cause, not primarily because of its justness and holiness, but because of his desperate need of something to hold to. And there's several scenes in the documentary which reference that quote indirectly. They don't mention the quote at all, but they, you know, the situations they describe are reflected in that quote. I really wish I could read a book by a historical anthropologist written a few hundred years from now on such groups. The insights, some of which I can only guess about, would be fascinating. I strongly suspect that there's a number of elements about dominance in relation to human reproductive behavior in such groups that they could really shed a light on. Not to mention the closeted homosexual nature of a lot of the members. Oh, and if you've heard Noah's recent diatribe on the scathing atheist about how dangerous it is to have Christians who are ignorant of the tenets of their religion, you will find this series confirms his comments. One of the things that Doug Coe says to people and members of The Family consider it to be a very powerful statement is Jesus plus nothing. And what he means that is you don't need anything other than Jesus. You don't even need the Bible. In fact, they hand people out their version of the New Testament. You know, they've already stripped out the Old Testament. Their version of the New Testament is simply the four Gospels and Acts. That's it. None of the other books in the New Testament. And God, it didn't say, but I kind of got the impression that the Gospels had been heavily edited. You know, so it wasn't even the full account.
All pay heed! The Lord Jehovah, has given unto you these 15... Ten commandments for all to obey.
From newschannel5.com, transgender student kicked out of Welch College following top surgery. It was a decision Yana Autry had been looking forward to for months, but it ended up getting him kicked out of the dorms at his school and suspended. Autry, a transgender student, had been looking forward to his breast reduction surgery, known as top surgery, for so long. When it was finally complete earlier this month, he shed tears of joy. I full-on started bawling and crying because this was something I wanted the last 10 years of my life, Autry said. He was a student at Welch College in Gallatin, where I live, who was planning to stay with a Christian couple as he healed from surgery. But when they found out what it was for, he says they told him he wasn't welcome anymore. After a roommate outed Autry last year, he says Welch College officials told him to keep quiet. Yana is the son of Christian missionaries and spent most of his life growing up in Bulgaria. His parents moved back to the States a few years ago so he could go to college at Welch. And the college has changed its name from Free Will Baptist Church College a few years ago. Guess the whole Jeebus thing wasn't working out for them. I had noticed in recent years that I was seeing billboards for Welch's college, and I got the impression that it was a private religious college, but I wasn't sure of this. And of course, this story just confirms it. But I can't recall seeing any billboards or things like that for Free Will Baptist College. So, yeah, they're probably looking to hide their whole Christian origins. I know Liberty University does that. A friend of mine some years back was telling me that he was looking, you know, for a place to go to get his master's degree. And I forget what it was in. And he got some literature from there, and he was looking at it, and it was all nice and neat and really liked it. Meaning everybody there was white in the pictures. And then he found out it was, you know, Liberty University that Liberty University was founded by Jerry Falwell and it was a religious school and all this, and he didn't go. And that was his comment. He says they really worked hard to hide the religious origins of the place. So I have a feeling Welch's is doing the same thing. To get back to Yanni, he's been alienated from his family, so he can no longer attend college and has no permanent place to live. He's planning on staying with a family friend for a few months in another state and then moving back to Nashville to work as a nursing assistant while going to school to get a degree in biology with a minor in theology. The article doesn't say where he's planning on going to school. Yana makes some contradictory statements in the interviews with him. He says that the whole reason that the school knew anything about this was a year ago his roommate was reading his diary and outed him to the school's administration. And Yana was living as a woman at that point in time, so it was a female roommate that he had. And at which point, he had to go to before a disciplinary hearing. And he was told there that he couldn't discuss his situation with any of the students, nor could he say anything which could be considered as advocating for LGBTQ+ rights. He describes how painful it was for him to have to keep silent when he heard students making jokes about LGBTQ+ people. But later, he says that he doesn't think that the student body has any issues with him being transgender, just the administration. That seems hard to reconcile with his comments about hearing students mock those in the LGBTQ+ community. I don't know, but it certainly seems to me that this kid is going to have a very tough life ahead of him, especially if he remains religious.
Everybody needs something to believe in, don't they, Reverend?
Bow down thine ear, O Lord, and hear me, for I am poor and needy. Preserve my soul, for I am holy. O thou, my God, save thy servant that trusteth in thee. Save him from this big mouth coos with a motor-driven ass who... Forgive me, Lord. I speak not in vain, but this little bitch provokes me so.
Oh, Jesus. At least I can stay in character.
From Indie100.com. American priest that banned black housekeeper from his property blames his racist dog. A Tennessee priest has blamed a black housekeeper from his property and then placed the blame squarely with his racist dog. The housekeeper in question, LaShundra Allen, said, "I was just supposed to clean the church, and I was supposed to go to the pastor's house and clean as well." They were just like, "Well, I'm not really sure how to say this," kind of like in a joking way, "but Father Jayek doesn't want black people cleaning the house because his dog is racist." The church is located in a suburb of Memphis called Collierville. It's almost 90% white, while Memphis is over 60% African American. The town's population remained fairly small until the 1960s. Then it began to grow exponentially, really taking off after Memphis elected their first black mayor. I don't think that I need to spell out why the town experienced a sudden growth in population starting around the time of the civil rights movement, and then exploding again after Memphis elected their first black mayor. Naturally, everyone who knows the priest says, "Oh, he's not a racist, it's his dog that's racist." Yeah, right.
Snakes. Why'd it have to be snakes?
Asps. Very dangerous. You go first.
AncientOrigins.net. Local historians to rebuild a 2,000-year-old Romano-Celtic temple. A group of local history enthusiasts in Britain have announced an amazing project. They have secured permission to rebuild a 2,000-year-old Romano-Celtic temple. The remains of the place of worship were going to be buried beneath the construction site, but the historians have saved them from destruction. The group have great plans for the temple and want to rebuild it and preserve it for the community. The article just shows a bunch of holes in the ground and some rocks and a jar, so I have no idea how they figured out that it was a temple or what it might have looked like. And there were other things found at that excavation site which apparently aren't worth preserving either, like an iron furnace and some other things. I guess, they're not going to preserve the buildings, but like the relics that have been found, those will be preserved outside of the temple. What struck me is that there are only 150 examples of temples like this that are known in Britain, but this one wasn't considered a rare enough historical building to save. Thankfully, the local group of historians have stepped up and are rebuilding the temple at another location. If they hadn't done that, then it would have been plowed under and a housing development built on top of it. Of course, I don't live in a country where every time you dig a couple of inches down, you pull up something from the Romans or the Celts, so maybe they feel 150 ancient temples is enough.
Who wants to go down the creepy tunnel inside the tomb first?
WashingtonPost.com. Tiny ancient amulets of deities, skulls, scarabs, phalluses unearthed in Pompeii. A stash of ancient amulets is seeing the light of day now that archaeologists in Pompeii have unearthed the treasures from under a pile of ash dating to the eruption of Mount Vesuvius in AD 79. The amulets are tiny and detailed. One is a petite glass engraving of Dionysus, the Greek god of wine, fertility, and religious ecstasy. Another shows an engraving of a dancing satyr. Other carvings depict skulls, phalluses, scarabs, and Harpocrates, the Hellenistic deity of silence and secrets, according to the Archaeological Park of Pompeii, the group that made the finding. These amulets were probably collected and used by a woman, either as a type of jewelry or to protect her from bad luck. Archaeologists are now studying their likely symbolism to understand their meaning and function. Massimo Osana, the general director at the Archaeological Park of Pompeii, said in a statement, They are objects of everyday life in the female world and are extraordinary because they tell micro-stories, biographies of the inhabitants of the city who tried to escape the eruption, Osana said. The amulets were found in the remains of a wooden box in one of the rooms of the House of the Garden, a site undergoing excavation at Pompeii. It's unclear whether the female owner of the amulets escaped the horrific eruption, although the majority of residents did. As evidence shows, many people resettled in nearby cities. If she did manage to flee to safety, however, the woman apparently didn't have time to grab her good luck charms, Osana noted. And I want to point out that that's a little optimistic because apparently they found the box in one room of the house and in the room right next door were the bodies of a number of men, women, and children. So I have a feeling that the owner perished along with her good luck charms. Interestingly, at least to me, a number of news sites went with a headline saying that the objects belonged to a sorcerer. Then in the body of the text, quote the experts as saying that the objects were clearly owned by a woman. Seems a little sexist to me, but maybe I'm wrong in thinking that the term sorcerer is primarily used to refer to men. Yet we do use the term sorceress, so it seems to me that it's kind of gendered, and while the dictionary sites I checked about the term sorcerer don't heavily gender the word in their description, they don't list the term as sorceress as being archaic or obsolete. Kind of an example of how, I guess, sexism, because people think sorcerer is more interesting than sorceress, leads to clickbait headlines, and even calling it a sorceress's things is wrong because, you know, they're described as being stuff that not necessarily an ordinary person would own, but certainly, you know, somebody in the middle class of the society in Pompeii would have owned, and not a, you know, sorcerer or sorceress would necessarily own.
Do you know what history is, mate? It's layers. The Romans make a layer, the Saxons, the medievals, Georgians, Victorians, your mum, my mum. So we have to take a peek.
From ancientorigins.net, again. Seductress's cave of depravity from Homer's Odyssey found? Italy's Mount Cicero, or Cape Cicero, is located about 60 miles south of Rome, and this promontory marks the southwestern limit of the former Pontine Marshes. This famous geological feature is named after a goddess called Circe, whom the ancient Greek writer Homer described as a temptress with the power to transform men into pigs. Deep within this mountain peninsula, scientists might have discovered her grotto along the Tom coastline. The mythological Circe featured in Homer's epic poem, The Odyssey, and this sexually charged enchantress was fathered by the god Helios, with her mother being either the nymph Perse or the goddess Hecate. According to the 3,000-year-old tale, Circe was a master, shouldn't that be mistress, of potions, herbs, and sorcery, and with her magic staff, she was renowned for transforming her victims into animals, and, in this instance, pigs. She transformed Odysseus's crew into pigs. There is some debate, according to the article, if this is actually the cave that inspired Homer's tale. The article cites scholars who claim that the sea levels were higher when Homer composed his tale, and this particular cave would have been underwater. In checking Wikipedia, this doesn't seem to be the case. According to it, sea levels have basically remained consistent over the past 6,000 years. And as a reminder, 3,000 years ago is roughly when the events of the Odyssey are said to have taken place. And judging by the photographs of the cave, even if the sea levels were a few meters higher, which is far higher than what they, you know, what the variation has been over the past 6,000 years, it's been a few centimeters, it would still have been accessible to people. And someone certainly spent time in the cave in ancient times, as the researchers found terracotta vases in the depths of it. These do not appear to have been dated, so who knows how long they've been there. The article does have one strike against the cave as being the one that inspired Homer, which seems damning to me. In the Odyssey, Circe is said to have lived on an island. The cave isn't on an island. Homer was pretty good at his geography. In one translation of the Odyssey I read, the translator described how he resolved any doubts he might have had about the modern island known as Ithaca as being the same one Homer described by taking a boat voyage towards the island at the same time of year and from the same direction as Homer described Odysseus taking when he returned. According to the translator, it all matched perfectly. You might also remember back in episode 176, I covered a story about astronomers using an eclipse to date the events covered in the Odyssey. That gave them a date of April 16th, 1178 BCE for when Odysseus slaughtered the suitors. So, you know, of course, we don't know if that happened, but there's awful lot of archaeological evidence which supports the non-supernatural elements of the tale. Whether or not there was somebody like Odysseus and he spent 10 years wandering after the Trojan War, we don't know. But we found a palace on Ithaca, as I recall. We've certainly found, I think, and this has been years and years ago, so I don't, I wouldn't even know how to dig it up. But they, I think it's Agamemnon's palace they think they found because they found, you know, things indicating that there was a huge feast, and then, you know, a few years later, it had obviously been wiped out, destroyed, which is what supposedly happened after Agamemnon returned from the Trojan War. You know, his wife murdered him, and then, you know, the gods took their revenge or whatever, and the whole kingdom just went to shit. So that seems to match up. Whether or not it's coincidence or not.
We used to look up in the sky and wonder at our place in the stars. Now just look down and worry about our place in the dirt.
From Mashable.com, Elon Musk's spacefaring Tesla Roadster finishes its first trip around the sun. A year in the life of Starman lasts about 557 of our Earth days. The Tesla Roadster that SpaceX sent into outer space in February 2018 has now completed one full orbit around the sun. The distance driven amounts to roughly 762 million miles, which according to Where is Roadster, means the car's 36,000-mile warranty has been exceeded more than 21,000 times. Good luck getting that thing serviced, Starman. It's been quite a journey for the spacesuit-clad dummy, who should still be positioned at the wheel of the spacefaring Roadster. He ended up there initially as part of a test launch for the Falcon Heavy, a reusable SpaceX rocket that's designed to carry heavy payloads beyond Earth's atmosphere. In case you'd forgotten about Elon Musk's publicity stunt to ensure that both Tesla and SpaceX get free advertising for years to come. And there you have an example of it. I was disappointed because the article does not discuss, you know, the likely effects of the Roadster being in space for a year. I read shortly after it was launched an article that discussed what they figured would likely happen to it and what kind of shape it would be in after a year, but I don't remember the article, and it would have been nice if this one had revisited the topic. They didn't. And it's also a shame that they turned the camera off on the Roadster after it left Earth orbit, because it would have been neat to still be able to pick up broadcast images of it, you know, what it could see while it was floating in space, but they quit doing that. But then again, that's because what's known as the Deep Space Network, which is the radio antenna set up on Earth designed to listen to all the messages being beamed back to Earth from our various space probes, is really heavily overloaded. So, you know, they can't keep listening for the Roadster, because if they're listening for the Roadster, that means they're not listening to, you know, Juno, which is orbiting Jupiter, or New Horizons, which is way out past Pluto, or, you know, the Mars rovers, or any of the things, the satellites we've got orbiting Mars, not to mention the probes we've got orbiting the Sun, may have one or two orbiting Venus, and the stuff we've got orbiting the Moon, we've got a couple there, as well as the International Space Station, things like that. So, you know, those are given actual science, whereas, you know, the Roadster was just given pretty pictures, but still, pretty pictures are nice.
Apollo 13 flight controllers, listen up. Give me a go, no go for launch. Booster.
Go.
Retro.
Go.
Vital.
We're go flying.
Guidance.
Guidance go.
Surgeon.
Go flight.
Ecom.
We're go flight.
GNC.
We're go.
Telmu.
Go.
Control.
Go flight.
Procedures.
Go.
Inco.
Go.
FAO.
We are go.
Network.
Go.
Recovery.
Go.
Capcom.
We're go flight.
Launch control, this is Houston. We are go for launch.
Roger that, Houston.
From Reuters.com, Sierra Nevada chooses United Launch Alliance's Vulcan to launch space station supply runs. Sierra Nevada Corp., a privately owned defense contractor with spaceflight ambitions, said on Wednesday it picked United Launch Alliance's Vulcan rocket to launch its Dream Chaser space plane on cargo missions to the International Space Station. Sierra Nevada Corp. is one of three companies hired by NASA, the U.S. Space Agency, to resupply the orbiting research laboratory under a $14 billion overall award that guarantees each company a minimum of six flights between 2019 and 2024. The other companies are Elon Musk's SpaceX and Northrop Grumman. SNC's Dream Chaser, which resembles the long-retired space shuttle, is slated to blast off from Florida's Cape Canaveral in late 2021 aboard a Vulcan Centaur rocket being built by United Launch Alliance, a joint venture of Boeing and Lockheed Martin. Dream Chaser will land like a conventional airplane at Florida's Kennedy Space Center, though Sierra Nevada says it has been developed to land on conventional airport runways. This is an interesting development in the commercial space race, because despite what the article says, the design origins go back farther than the space shuttle. In the waning days of World War II, an Air Force designer at Wright-Patterson Air Force Base in Dayton developed a concept for a manned spacecraft which would later be known as the Dinosaur when development on it began in the late 1950s. The Dream Chaser resembles that more than it does the space shuttle. Of course, most people have never heard of the Dinosaur, so that's probably why they went with the space shuttle. The only reason I know about the Dinosaur is because of who the designer was. That was a guy by the name of Alex Tremulous, who was the lead designer on the Tucker car. This version of the craft is automated, but there are plans to make versions which can carry people. In the early 2000s, before NASA canceled the idea, the Dream Chaser was supposed to remain docked at the ISS to serve as an evacuation vehicle. This would have been significant since it would have allowed the number of astronauts on board the ISS to increase from 3 to 7. Right now, the number of astronauts on the ISS averages about 3, except when a new crew was sent up. Then there will be 6. That's because the Soyuz capsules, which are used to send people to the ISS, can only hold 3 people, and they have a Soyuz capsule permanently docked at the ISS, so if there's an emergency and they have to abandon the space station, they can all dive into that and get out of there. They don't have enough docking ports to have more than 2 Soyuz capsules attached to the station at one time. I think they may have increased the number of docking ports on the station, but I'm not sure. But they certainly haven't increased the number of astronauts, and they don't seem to have any more Soyuz capsules parked at the ISS other than the one, at least from what I could find in reading. Back when the shuttles were flying, though, you could have as many as 10 people on the ISS. Whenever Musk gets his manned Dragon capsules flying, the number of people which it can ferry up to the ISS is 7, meaning that there could potentially be as many as 14 people on the ISS at one time, if they have a Dragon parked there as an escape vehicle, or they have a manned version of the Dream Chaser there docked as an escape vehicle. But even if they start sending people up on the Dream Chaser, don't expect too many tourists to use it. The last figures I saw for how much it costs to launch something using a ULA rocket were significantly higher than it would cost to use a SpaceX rocket, which makes me wonder why the folks who build the Dream Chaser went with ULA. The best I can figure is that the ULA folks dangled the idea of an acquisition of Sierra Nevada as part of the deal, which Musk would be unlikely to do. ULA was created to manage the launch of the space shuttles, and since the shuttles are no longer flying, they've not been able to come up with a manned craft design for some reason.
Greetings, my friend. We are all interested in the future, for that is where you and I are going to spend the rest of our lives. And remember, my friend, future events such as these will affect you in the future.
From Axios.com, Icelandic activists host funeral for nation's first glacier to go extinct. About 100 people in Iceland trekked 2 hours up a volcano to formally bid farewell to a glacier once known as Ökjökull, offering their condolences to the ice mass that disappeared about a decade ago, AP reports. This was the nation's first glacier to formally go extinct, but Icelandic geologist Odur Sigurðsson says it won't be the last. He predicts all of the nation's glaciers will be gone in 200 years as temperatures continue to rise as a result of man-made climate change, causing global sea level to rise. The glacier had been 6 square miles wide and was a source of clean drinking water. They put a plaque on the site where they held the funeral, and the English translation just gets to me. Here it is. A letter to the future. Okay is the first Icelandic glacier to lose its status as a glacier. In the next 200 years, all our glaciers are expected to follow the same path. This monument is to acknowledge that we know what is happening and what needs to be done. Only you will know if we did it. August 2019, 450 parts per million CO2. Now remember, current projections seem to be underestimating how fast such things are supposed to occur. Greenland's ice is presently melting at a rate which was not expected to happen until 2070. At best, this means that the projections are off by about 50 years. In my non-expert opinion, however, one should think of global warming not as a pot of water slowly coming to a boil, but as a boulder rolling downhill, rapidly picking up steam. So don't be surprised if you next hear them saying that Greenland's ice is melting at levels we weren't expecting to see until sometime after 2100 in the very near future.
I've said it before and I'll say it again. Democracy simply doesn't work.
From CNET.com. DARPA's $10 million voting machine couldn't be hacked at DEF CON for the wrong reasons. For the majority of DEF CON, and for those of you who don't know, DEF CON is an annual convention in Las Vegas where everybody who's anybody in the tech industry goes to discuss security issues. Usually what happens is like a couple of days before they have what's known as the Black Hat Conference, which is a similar conference, but a little different. I'm not sure exactly what the differences are. And then, you know, they have the DEF CON conference. All the tech journalists I follow go to the event, say the same thing. When they go, as soon as the plane touches down in Las Vegas, they turn their phones off. They leave. They don't mess with any of their electronic devices because it is, you know, there's people there who their whole goal is just to hack things, and they don't trust anything. There was a report on one of the things where somebody went out and like a week or so before this conference, did a survey of how many cell towers were on in the area. And there was like 10. And then they did a survey when DEF CON was happening, and it was like over 100. Now, when there's a big conference in places like Las Vegas, the cell phone companies will bring out portable cell towers that they set up to handle the extra load. But there's also a thing called the Stingray 2, which pretends to be a cell tower, and if your phone connects to it, it can gather all kinds of information off your phone. And that's what at least some of those 100, or, you know, those additional cell towers were. But back to the article. Hackers couldn't crack the $10 million secure voting machine prototypes that DARPA had set up at the Voting Village. But it wasn't because of the machine's security features that the team had been working on for 4 months. The reason, technical difficulties during the machine's setup. Eager hackers couldn't find vulnerabilities in the DARPA-funded project during the security conference in Las Vegas because a bug in the machines didn't allow hackers to access their systems over the first 2 days. The machines are supposed to be able to, you know, connect to the internet, or, you know, you're supposed to be able to plug in a USB key or a computer into them, you know, to transfer stuff off of them and to update the software. And for some reason, these things weren't working. DARPA is the Defense Advanced Research Projects Agency. Galloy brought 5 machines, and each one had difficulties during the setup, said Joe Kinnery, a principal research scientist at the government contractor. Now, if the experts can't get the machines up and running so that they can be checked for vulnerabilities, how the fuck are local election officials going to get them up and running for an election? That's a disturbing thought. But let me say, however, that the machines are designed with the right principles in mind. Everything about the machines is open source, which means that anyone interested can study the software code in the machines to look for flaws in it, as well as to verify that the machines work the way they're supposed to. This is in contrast to voting machines which run on Windows, Mac OS, or a proprietary software system. And I believe most of the voting machines run on, most of the electronic voting machines either run on Windows or a proprietary software system. In years past, the people at DEF CON and the Black Hat Conference have shown up with voting machines that they bought off of eBay when a area decides, well, we're getting new machines, so let's sell our old machines. They've brought these machines they bought off eBay, set them up there, and they've been insanely easy to hack. And some of them still had voter information left on them. They hadn't been wiped like you should do. And the reason open source is so important is because it's easier to analyze the code on an open source machine than one running Windows or a proprietary system. Because if you've never written computer code, you wouldn't know this. But when somebody writes software code, they sit there and they put in things like, they put in little messages, you know, this section does this, this section does that, things like that, little bits of information. If you don't have the original source code, you can't get that. There are what's known as decompilers, which will reverse engineer the software, but they won't spit out the little notes. So you have to then go through and figure out, well, what is this section of code trying to do? And, you know, if you come up with an idea and you think, well, okay, it does this, and then you go along down here and somewhere else, you realize, no, it can't do what I thought it did. It's got to do something else. Then you got to start all over again. The open source is what you want because it makes it easier to analyze the code for flaws. And it's also technically illegal to reverse engineer the code in something like Windows or proprietary software. You can thank things like the DMCA, the Digital Millennium Copyright Act, for this. And yes, people who have found flaws in computer software have been threatened with criminal prosecution despite the fact that all they did with the information about the flaw was to hand it over to the company which made the software. No shit. It's a huge issue in the tech community because, you know, the software companies want to protect their, you know, their intellectual property and are worried that if everybody can read the code, then, you know, they'll just copy their software. But they don't realize that if people can't access the code and check it for flaws, you know, it's hard. That software may not be fixed. If you read all the stuff that Edward Snowden did, you know, when he dumped the thing, there were all kinds of security flaws in software and hardware and all this that the government knew about, that the corporations that made the stuff didn't know about. The government's kept it quiet because it made it easier to hack into systems that they wanted to check out. And without the ability of experts to examine the code and hardware used on these machines, it's impossible for us to know if our elections are safe and secure. Given the fact that the Russians have done a lot to influence our recent elections, this should concern everyone listening. And, you know, the other thing about it being open source is there are all sorts of groups of experts who are specialized in, you know, verifying the code and checking the code for mistakes. So you're not going to the same five people to get the code checked. You have a broad variety of people you can choose from, which means that if you have reason to suspect that this person isn't trustworthy or isn't as good as they need to be, there are plenty of other people out there to choose from. And it also means that a town that feels there's a problem with their software on their voting machines could have it checked by experts, even if the state or the federal government didn't think that there was a problem with those voting machines. You know, since we're going to use electronic voting machines or we're going to use some form of electronic vote counting, because even in states where they have paper ballots, they feed those paper ballots into machine readers that read it. Now, if there's a recount, then they go by the hand, you know, the paper ballots. But not every place does that. And what the fuck you're going to do if ballot boxes are missing? Well, they're going to go by the electronic total. So we need, you know, if we're going to have the electronic machines, which we're going to have because everybody wants their election results as soon as possible, then we need to have open source software and hardware. And it has to be open source hardware because then there are people who can check the code that the computer chips have to make sure that, you know, there's no malware implanted in those.
If I'm wrong, nothing happens. We go to jail peacefully, quietly. We'll enjoy it. But if I'm right, and we can stop this thing, Lenny, you will have saved the lives of millions of registered voters.
From thehill.com. First House Republican backs bill banning assault weapons. Representative Pete King of New York is the first House Republican to back a bill in the chamber seeking to ban assault weapons. They are weapons of mass slaughter, King told the New York Daily News on Monday, shortly after his support for the assault weapons ban of 2019 as a co-sponsor became public on Congress's website. I don't see any need for them in everyday society, he added. The bill rolled out in February by Representative David Cicilline, a Democrat from Rhode Island, has 200 Democratic co-sponsors, which is almost all of them in the House. It would ban semi-automatic firearms and large-capacity magazines, proposals which have drawn more attention following back-to-back mass shootings in El Paso, Texas, and Dayton, Ohio, that left a combined 32 dead and dozens more injured earlier this month. Now, let me point out that that Peter King is human garbage, and he's not to be confused with Steve King, who I'll be talking about later on. Peter King is human garbage because he's been a supporter of the Irish Republican Army. King has held hearings on Capitol Hill where he basically harassed ordinary Muslims for not actively trying to stop terrorism, as if your run-of-the-mill Muslim knows a terrorist. Surprisingly, however, he's not at all bothered by the connections between the IRA and the PLO. And these connections go back to when the PLO was actively blowing shit up in Israel. I can't find the clip or I dropped the audio into the podcast, but the Daily Show did a pretty in-depth piece on him about 8 years ago, which featured a video of him being literally spitting mad over the British, just in general, not specifically their actions in Northern Ireland. Still, if someone like him can stand up to the NRA and say we need to ban these weapons of war, then we might have a chance to make some progress on guns in the U.S. And speaking of the NRA, they might be on the verge of collapse. They're being sued by a high-powered donor because of the lavish spending by NRA President Wayne LaPierre. There's been a number of high-profile resignations from the organization in the past couple of weeks, and their arguments trying to defend easily availability of high-powered rifles have gotten more absurd. Florida, home to a pair of horrific mass shootings, one at the Pulse nightclub and the other at the Marjorie Stoneman Douglas High School, is looking at legislation to ban assault rifles. A lobbyist for the NRA testifying before the state government said, "How do you tell a 10-year-old girl that the rifle she got for Christmas is an assault weapon and she has to give it up or risk arrest on felony charges? Lest you think that no one would ever be dumb enough to let their kid handle a high-powered rifle, in 2014, an instructor at a gun range in Arizona was killed while trying to show a 9-year-old girl how to fire a fully automatic Uzi at the request of her father. Children finding guns and shooting someone is so common in the U.S., that the stories rarely make the national news. I follow a number of gun safety advocates on Twitter, and almost every day, at least one of them will post a story about a kid finding a gun and shooting someone with it. Not to mention the three guys arrested this past week who were plotting mass shootings. And shootings in Chicago are so common that they barely rate a mention in the news there. Imagine the same is true in Memphis, which has a higher rate of gun violence than Chicago does. Of course, even if this ban on assault weapons does pass the House, it has to make it through the Senate, and Mitch McConnell seems hell-bent on blocking everything sent his way.
"You'll bring them death, and they will love him for it."
And I suppose I'd be remiss if I didn't mention something about Iowa Republican Steve King. What is it with guys named King in the House anyway? Saying that if it weren't for rape and incest, half the human race wouldn't be here. Given his racist comments in the past, you know, when he said that he couldn't think of anything non-whites had contributed to society, these comments really shouldn't surprise anyone. White supremacists only see women as incubators whose sole purpose in life is to give birth to more babies, preferably male. They do not see any other reason for women to exist. King, as per usual, said out loud what many Republicans think, but would never dare to speak. It's even discussed in the family documentary I talked about at the beginning of the episode. At least a few Republicans, however, have decided that he's gone too far. Republican Paul Mitchell from Michigan has said that he will be donating to King's opponent in the primary. Republican Steve Stivers from Ohio has said that he's seriously considering doing the same. And in the 2018 election, the Republican Party gave King no support in that election. His opponent, who's a Democrat, came within 3 points of beating him. In the previous election, King beat his opponent by double digits. With any luck, he'll be out of office after the next election.
Spring time for Hitler and Germany.
A final note before I get out of here. Despite Trump's claims that the economy is doing great, his administration is looking at making cuts to payroll taxes to offer a temporary boost to the economy. If he does this, and you're an American, I suggest that you immediately have the withholding rate on your taxes increased, especially if you're someone who structures your taxes so that you get a small refund. Why? Because what invariably happens when they do this is that when you go to file your taxes, you will find that instead of getting a refund, you owe money. Lots of money. And with the economy headed for the dumpster, you might find it very hard to come up with the necessary cash to pay the IRS. I got burned once by that back when W was in office. And immediately after I filed my taxes and found out that I owed money, I went to the HR department where I was working and had my withholding rate increased so that I didn't have to worry about it happening again. I was barely able to pay the amount that I owed, so brace yourselves. They might be stupid enough to do it this year, in which case people would see smaller refunds or a tax bill in an election year. Or they might hold off until after the first of the year, knowing that people wouldn't discover they'd been conned until after the election. Either way, it's not a good thing. And, you know, if you're like me and you live on the margins, it's not something you can really afford to have happen to you. Because, you know, when it happened to me, I was making like $9 an hour. And, you know, I had to, and my original tax bill, when I started figuring out, it was like $1,000 something. There's no way I can pay this. So I immediately went back through and found enough deductions that I could get the expenses down to, you know, to my tax bill to a few hundred dollars, which I really couldn't afford to pay. But, you know, if you don't pay it, you get to go to jail. So I paid it and, you know, then had my withholding rate changed. Because, you know, I can't afford to do that. I just can't. And I know I've got listeners who are in the same boat.
That's it for this episode of the Atheist in the Trailer Park podcast. You can subscribe to the show on iTunes, Stitcher, as well as just about anywhere else podcasts can be found. Many of the episodes are also on YouTube. Follow the show on Twitter. At TParkAtheist is the show's Twitter handle. It's on Facebook at facebook.com/trailerparkatheist.com. If you happen to like the podcast, please rate it on iTunes. If you'd like to support the podcast, there's a donate button on the show notes page. You can support it via Patreon at patreon.com/TNTucker. Thanks for listening.
Say goodnight, Fuzznuts.
All I know is this violates every canon of respectable broadcasting.
Damned cat.